The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Give us grace so to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
The first lesson for today is taken from Isaiah 25. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations, and he will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Second lesson is from Revelation. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. And he will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I'm making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." And some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord. I speak to you in the name of the living God, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus is not the hero of this story. Jesus is not the hero of this story. Though Mary and Martha and all of their friends and those gathered there really want him to be, and
of this story. Although we, in our loss, at the bedside, the graveside of those we love, implore God to heal and give strength and give life, we know that sometimes it doesn't happen that way. It doesn't always happen in the ways that we yearn for and long for and ask for. It doesn't always look like God is there. God's ways certainly are not our ways. And though death and this story, this gospel today, raises many questions and leaves many questions unanswered, it does teach us three things, at least, about God. One, God is mystery. God's ways, not our ways. God's timing is not our own. What is an ending in our sight is also a birth in the eyes and the hands of God. In this gospel and in the gospel, we see God making all things, even and including and especially death, new. We see God creating unceasingly in love, which is to our eyes and our minds and our hearts an eternal mystery. And number two, because God's ways so exceed and defy our ways, because to our eyes, physical death is inarguably an ending. And because in physical death, we, the yet living, are changed. And because we, in the physical death of our loved ones, our hearts are broken irrevocably. What we learn in the gospel, especially today, is that God's heart is breaking too. God in Jesus cries. He breaks down, he loses it. Because death breaks us. Death hurts. As Martha points out, death stinks. We weep and wail together, and in the silence and quietness of our own solitude. And we see right before us today that God does too. Neither in death nor in sorrow are we left comfortless. And so, number three, the center of the story is God. And we are gifts and creation and people and players and saints in that story. The center is God. A theologian I read a lot, as you know if you've been listening to my sermons for a while, is named Sam Wells, and he writes and talks about some distinctions between the hero, of which Jesus is not today, and a saint. A hero, think about it, is the center of the story. The adventures of insert hero's name here. The travels, the conquests of said hero. In distinction, saints, Martha, Mary, Lazarus, those in the Jewish community of which they were a part, are on the margins. They're on stage, but in the chorus. They're on the periphery. They are often backstage, acting out of their faith and their hope in ways sometimes seen and often unseen. The story of a hero is told in such a way to highlight their attributes, their strength, their ability to jump from building to building, their ability to vanish, their cool case. I guess I'm wearing one today, but that's beside the point. How cool are the heroes? In contrast, saints, maybe known for their particular interest, Francis's fascination with creation, for example. We know them as the patron saints of one idea or cause or interest of another. But what distinguishes the saint is their faith. A saint is known by their faith. And we as saints, those of us who may consider ourselves to be in the communion of saints, and I believe that we are, our prayer is that we are known by our faith. As one of my dad's favorite songs says, may those who come behind us find us faithful. May our lives and actions light their way. May they, as they look back through our lives, remember and be inspired by our faith. That distinguishes a saint. Another thing about a hero is that a hero will operate in scarcity. For a hero, there is never enough, and so the valuable must be conquered, must be stolen, must be captured, must be obtained. In the communion of saints, scarcity has no place. In the communion of saints, there is only abundance and the overflowing of love, such that a saint can only share of their gifts, of their love, and of their faith. A hero avoids failure at all costs. A hero avoids failure at all costs because it would detract from their strength or from the telling and recounting of their strength. A saint dwells in failure, embraces failure because it is, first of all, an opportunity to share and receive the gifts of others. Failure in the life of a saint is a time to revel and manifest that the strength that they may have is not their own. It is of God. Moreover, a saint revels in failure because it is an opportunity for forgiveness and reconciliation and acknowledgement of brokenness. And that in that brokenness, we see this case.
as St. Cohen says, are how the light gets in. And finally, though a hero operates and travels and conquests on one's own, a saint is never alone and would never think to be alone. Did you know that the word saints comes up in the New Testament 64 times, looking at Barbara, and that it is never in the singular? It is always the plural, saints. Saints, communion, fellowship divine of saints. Where two or three are gathered, there certainly is God. On this All Saints Day, we remember and revel and cherish the multitude of saints. Some of our own blessed memory who live and inspire our hearts every day, even in our hearts' brokenness. Many saints who have lived and gone on well before us, and many saints who will live and go on well after us. On this All Saints Day, we rejoice that at the grave and beyond the grave, we make our song with the saints in heaven and on earth and yet to come. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Let us pray for the church and for the world.
God of love, we pray for your church. For Michael, our presiding bishop, Bonnie, our bishop, Emily, Anthony, and David, our priests, and for all who seek and serve you in the community of the faithful, equip us with compassion and love to carry out your work of reconciliation in the world. God of love,
hear our prayer.
God of freedom, we pray for our nation and for all the nations of this world, for peace and unity across barriers, for elected and appointed leaders, that they would serve the common good. Inspire all people with courage to speak out against hatred, to actively resist evil. Unite the human family in bonds of love. God of freedom, God of justice, we pray for the earth, your creation entrusted to our care. We pray for those affected by wildfires, hurricanes, and climate change. Stir up in us a thirst to protect the earth and all its resources, that all men live in safety and abundance. God of justice, God of joy, we celebrate those good birthdays this week, including David, Nathaniel,
Mary,
Clara,
Josephine, Barbara,
and those we now name. God of joy, hear our prayer. God of mercy, we pray for all in any time of need or trouble. For refugees and prisoners, for the sick and suffering, the lonely and despairing, for those facing violence, for all held down by prejudice or injustice, awaken in us compassion and assurance of your spirit. We pray especially for
Pat, Holly, Gloria, Isabella, Barbara, Kathy, Ed, Richard,
Amen. and those we now name. God of mercy, God of grace, we pray for those who have died, for the faithful in every generation who have worked for justice, for martyrs who died in persecution, for prophets who follow us toward reconciliation, and for all the communion of saints. Make us faithful to your word, and bring us at last into the glorious company of the saints in light. We pray especially for Barbara Rose Collins, sister of Lamar Richardson, and Millicent, mother of Desmond Jones, and especially for those we now name. God of grace.
Hear our prayers, Holy God. Breathe your spirit over us and all the earth, that barriers crumble and divisions cease. Make us more fully your co-healers of the beautiful and broken world. Unite us with all people in bonds of love that the whole earth and all its peoples may praise you and be at peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Liza and Richard and Ed and all of you saints who have participated in All Souls and All Saints celebrations this entire week. It has been remarkable, and you have my thanks. Liza is correct that sacristans, members of the Altar Guild, are definitely among those behind the scenes saints. So if you like to work backstage, it's for you. It's a beautiful thing.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice.